This week I received the news, like many of you, of Wal Thornhill's passing. I wish to pay tribute with this article. Wal was a mentor to us all in the most important field of all, the true nature of our universe. Wal's many theories and predictions succeeded because he sought the truth, not for credentials, funding, accolades, or power. He sought the truth for the sake of knowing, as we all should. It's the true intent of science. It's the true source of joy. I began this article weeks ago to discuss the truth. It was never intended to be about Wal. It was and still is about truth seekers in the electric universe. The title, Shine On You Crazy Diamond, is an ode to garage experimenters, theorists, scientists, and deep thinkers everywhere who are grounded and harmonized with natural frequencies. But Wal was the epitome of such people. No BS got past Wal. Believe me, I tested him. So the title now takes added meaning, as things always do in a fractal universe. How do you know the truth when you see it? It's because you recognize a pattern. You trust yourself to know what you're seeing, hearing, or feeling. You know because it resonates within you. A pattern from memory, like a mother's face, is a pattern that harmonizes heart and soul. And you know. There is no doubt the instant you recognize mom's face, or whoever is your closest, every bone in your body knows it. It's something everyone does, but it isn't the work of a conscious mind. It's the work of an observant state of being. It involves every sense, conscious and unconscious, mind and body, the whole antenna resonates. Like riding a bicycle, your mind doesn't tell your body how to keep balance. It just does, as long as you stop thinking and just pay attention. When I first stumbled into the Thunderbolts project, I didn't have a clue what I was going to write about. I just knew I found the right place. In the first weeks, I binged on Thunderbolts videos, especially Michael Steinbacher. I watched all of his. As an engineer with the smattering of geology experience, it made sense to look for electrical evidence on the Earth. After all, it's accessible, more so than telescopes, particle beams, and buzzy high-voltage labs. Michael's videos led me to an addiction. Google Earth. I've always had a thing for maps. There are patterns, always patterns. Whether looking at highways, cities, airline routes, or topography, there is a wealth of information in the patterns. Earth's topography is patterned. I couldn't put a finger to how or why, but I could see patterns that stretch for thousands of miles that had no reasonable explanation. There were repeating patterns, geometric patterns. Some patterns were similar to other planets, yet others were unique. There had to be a reason. I had already dismissed conventional thinking at this point, of course, and reasoned these features must be electric. We see plainly electric scarring on planets and moons, and the electric atmospheres of the gas giants. So it must be on Earth. But why does Earth look so complex? I stumbled, again, always stumbling, into evidence of shockwaves on hillsides. It came about because I searched craters and found a blog by a guy who was a demolitions expert. He was writing about shockwave features on hillsides near his home and proposing they were crater rims. He recognized harmonic tetrahedral patterning caused by sonic shock because he'd spent a career in the military analyzing the blast zones of heavy ordnance. He was a man who knew shockwaves when he saw them. As a mechanical engineer, I have a good amount of experience with such things myself. Shockwaves, yes, but more importantly, I learned to listen to technicians like this guy. The operators, the mechanics, the people who are hands-on. If you want to know the process, don't ask the people who manage it. Ask the people who operate it. Beyond already knowing about something about shock diamonds, I innately trusted this guy, knew his patterns, even though he had no academic credentials. I began searching for these patterns. Lo and behold, they are everywhere. Not only did I find harmonic tetrahedrons created by compression zones called separation bubbles, formed where a supersonic wave impinges on a surface, I found multiple features of fine detail, distinct to shockwaves, embedded in rocks, mountains, and entire mountain chains. Scalable, harmonic, self-similarity, plastered across the global landscape everywhere I looked, could only be from one cause: sustained plasma storms. I finally had evidence from personal investigation, from a position of knowing, what caused patterns, at least many that I saw on Earth, and that we indeed live in an electric universe. Only a charged environment could develop supersonic winds that could freeze rock in situ in the precise form of a shockwave. Coulomb force and recombination is the only process that makes physical sense. A dusty plasma environment would accelerate winds to supersonic speeds, rippling the landscape wherever shock waves reflected and segregating winds by step voltage and ionic density. To produce what I witness on Earth's crust, Earth's atmosphere had to be a rainbow-banded chemical soup like Jupiter's atmosphere. There had to be several global storms to produce the layers of geology and episodic fossil evidence of extinctions, a recurring nightmare. And since I've written several articles showing the shock features in detail, showing self-similarity between Jupiter's storms and landforms on Earth, and exploring many other geologic examples of electrical formation and scarring, I know what I'm showing you is the truth. The patterns speak for themselves. My explanations may suck. I may not describe the electric circuit properly or organize my streams of consciousness well. But the geology is there. Jupiter is there. Winds, storms, rocks. It's all out there to go look at for yourself. The data I use is open source, available to anyone with an internet connection. One can research shockwave patterns, standing waves, separation bubbles, and anything else I write about with a few clicks of a mouse. You can see the patterns for yourself. It's the only thing that will invoke faith, because that is what knowing the truth comes down to, faith. This brings me to the point. Faith is how you know the truth. Faith in yourself. Do you believe your lying eyes? I'm not speaking about faith in God, although that is the ultimate faith. I'm using a small f faith to mean conviction in any particular realm, such as the faith one has they can unerringly find their mother's face in a crowd, or ride a bike. It's a reliance on all your senses, conscious and unconscious. You recognize the pattern and your gut, heart, and soul resonates. It feels right. It's common sense. When you know, you know. How else can one know they are objective unless they know and trust themselves? It's an internal thing to be confident in oneself. And the only way to satisfy that is to see, hear, and feel for yourself. Relying on someone else's word makes one a parrot. Now this brings to question, how can I have faith I know what I'm seeing when pretty much the entire world of academia knows I'm wrong? And that tectonic forces like subduction, expansion, and uplift created mountains, plus billions and billions of years, blah, blah, blah. Because they don't show you anything but drawings and models. They can't explain or even try the fractal forms, the harmonic repetitions, the phase-angled vectors of frequency interference. Their explanations don't explain. They describe processes that no one has ever seen. The one thing they never talk about is electricity and circuits, which is like explaining life without mentioning breathing. And if you dig down to their fundamental assumptions that underlie the whole house of cards, you'll find it's based on unfalsifiable, billions and billions of years, dark energy type, dreamed up concepts, force-fed by whatever Humpty Dumps were in charge. In other words, to believe them is to trust them rather than yourself. And they're idiots. I also know, because I worked in the energy industry, that much of science is political, not truthful. It's marketing. It's meant to persuade you, not inform you. This corruption is pervasive throughout quackademia. If you seek the truth without fear or bias, you'll know when you find it because you'll find confirmation. It will present itself. You just need to be aware. A week ago, I camped on flat alluvial plain covered in gravel near the Colorado River. I knew the plain to be a windblown feature created in the arc blast of a discharge event. It had nothing to do with ancient riverbed, as consensus theory would have you believe. So I began examining the gravel. It was predominantly typical river rock, rounded by water erosion, as consensus theory goes. But as I picked up rock after rock, a specific pattern became evident. Many, if not most, of the rocks I looked at had a flat side. One side was rounded and polished as if washed by sand and water, but the other side was flat, which entirely confirmed my expectation because I suspected such gravel to be the result of rock rain. These river rocks fell like rain after being blasted into the sky as molten glass and reconstituted as drops and hailstones. The ones that were still hot and molten inside but had a cooled crust landed like pudding drops, making the flat bottom and the top, exposed to wind still screaming, made elongated and rounded streamlined tops to the drops. You know these rocks. They're the best ones to skip across a lake. The flat bottom is the tell. Water erosion does not explain that. The rock rain was a pleasant surprise. I wasn't looking for it. It was just there where I camped. This happens almost continuously from things as mundane as gravel, because the entire planet is evidence. One will also find along the way people like the demolitions expert, whose blog and identity is somewhere in the Wayback Machine. I'd like to thank and credit him. I just lost his identity. Obscure blogs and videos arrive in my streams weekly that either inspire new insight or confirm a prior postulation. Seek and you will find, because that's part of the pattern. I watch YouTube channels with less than 500 subscribers who know better than professors, people with no academic background but with curious minds who examine magnetism and electricity with products from eBay. I listen to people with spiritual connections whose faith comes from experiences scoffed at by consensus science. I read random articles in the news, find rocks here and there. I live a continuous stream of synchronicities. Information specific to my questions arrives at my doorstep, as if asking the right question is all the invitation nature needs. The universe wants to show itself to those who want the truth. The evidence is everywhere. Personal observation led us to know that the universe is electric. We all recognize the obvious: plasma nebula, swirling galaxies, and everywhere the blaze of electromagnetic balls of discharge called stars. We can see what a crater really is, and therefore lose no sleep wondering why so many are hexagonal. We know, thanks to Haltnar, that redshift isn't a measuring stick, and his evidence alone makes the whole Big Bang thing nonsense. We know weather and climate is the Earth's circuitry in action, and therefore aren't ashamed by our carbon footprint. What binds us all is truly electric. The ether flows through us as the light and warmth that generates the hologram. So there must be a common carrier wave at its frequency we all receive. Wouldn't any creature evolve the ability to hear it, given its all-encompassing preeminence? Notwithstanding the uniquely human inability to listen, it seems a natural thing for life to feel that energy. Think of the mysterious animal behaviors, like foreknowledge of severe weather and earthquakes, a pet knowing when a master is on the way home. Telepathic signals are real, in my humble opinion, and they have a physics. But one must acknowledge an ether and look inward to find how to tune in. In this regard, we are all scientists, by my definition. We each took a look and said, "That's electric," because it so obviously is. Recognizing the obvious is critical thinking. Manipulating math to invent invisible forces, energies, and matter is, of course, the ultimate woo. One can make math simulate anything if you're the one making the rules. Truth comes about due to intent. Truth is accessible to anyone with the unflinching intent to find it and speak it, because it's out there waiting for you. As more people become tired of the BS, they will look for new answers. I expect many will find us. I expressed this expectation to Wal late last year in a few brief email exchanges. He agreed the future will be amazing. He also said, keep finding the patterns. Why I think this is a fitting testimony for Wal is because he and Dave created this environment to explore truth. And that is Wal's legacy. Cheers to anyone who follows it. Shine on, you crazy diamond. Thank you.